garner you free.
Which is true. But let's be encouraged to know that worship is being taken place right now across this country, across this world. You are just one of many, many believers proclaiming the name of Jesus Christ as Lord. And I just hope that we will come together just hungry for the presence of God. That we would be less concerned about who's on the platform or the order of service or how anything looks around us, but that we wouldn't miss the presence of Jesus Christ. I hope that's why you're here this morning. It's to worship the God that deserves all praise.
Rescue the souls of men. Oh, you
Thank you, worship team.
Church this morning. Praise God that we have Christ.
Amen.
I'm just so in awe of how gracious He is this morning. And we're here not because we're great, right? We are not great. And praise God for that. Praise God that He is great. And we don't have to be. So let's just dwell on that this morning as we go together to the Lord in prayer. Before we pray together, I just want to mention the missionaries of the month, which is Tim and Nicole Fox. And they're just asking that we be praying for them as they're helping Tim move his parents. So he's going to be moving them from the farm to a town or to Brick. So let's just hear this word of the Lord this morning. This is Matthew chapter 6. Just the Lord guiding us in prayer. This is Jesus saying, "And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they'll be heard for their many words. Don't be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. Pray then like this: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." Let's just pray together this morning. Our Father, thank you for your grace. Your grace is amazing. That you would extend such kindness to us as wicked people. And you do meet us in our weaknesses. We are so thankful. Father, may your name be kept holy. May your name and your name alone be hallowed. We do not have great names, but you do. You are so worthy of all our praise. You who are the creator, the all-powerful, who can speak and create life. And Father, we are grateful that you have done that in our souls, that you've spoken and caused us to have new life. We're just so grateful for your goodness. So, Father, we do want to see your kingdom come. We grow so weary of seeing sin and Satan having their way so often. And we're tired, Father. We're tired of that. We do understand that Satan is on a leash, and that you are in absolute control. But Lord, we do want to come and just see your kingdom expand. We want to see you break the power of sin and Satan all over. In our homes, in our town, in our nation, in our world. So Lord, come and do the work that only you can do. The Almighty. Come and create new life. Father, we do ask that you provide for us. We are so thankful that you do provide for us every single day in thousands of ways that we'll never even know. We're grateful that we can all be here clothed and fed. We're thankful that you've provided. We're thankful that you have provided us Bibles that we can be spiritually fed. We're thankful that you've provided this church. You've raised up these souls and created this family. That we can be here this morning to hear your word proclaimed. So, Father, we ask that you provide for your sheep this morning, that you would come and feed their souls, that you would provide for Haddon as he's shepherding us. We ask that you would just give him great power through your word. Soften our hearts, Lord. Forgive us. We get so distracted. We are so prone to wander. And we are just grateful that you are the kind shepherd that nudges us back and you come after us. We're thankful. Father, we want to ask that you would provide for Tim and his parents as they're moving in. We ask that you would please just help that to go smoothly. Give them the strength they need. Father, there's a lot of sickness going around this season. We just ask that you provide health for us. There's a lot of pain, spiritually and physically. Father, we ask that you provide. We trust you as the Almighty Healer, that one day these bodies will be made new. We so look forward to that day. But more importantly, we look forward to the day we get to just be in your presence physically, to praise you, the Almighty King. Father, we want to lift up Aiden Miller as he goes into heart surgery this week. Please just grant the doctor wisdom and great success. We ask that it just go really smoothly. And Lord, for anyone who's suffering, we ask that you would just sustain their faiths. You would feed their souls and get them through this. We ask that for Aiden, that you would just comfort him. And surgery is always nerve-wracking. And we're just grateful, God, that you are sovereign and that we can absolutely trust you 100%. We're thankful that you're faithful when we're not. And that said, God, we just ask that you would forgive us of our sins. Help us to be forgiving one another and to be living out the gospel every single day. Unite us, Lord, as a people, that we would just display Christ, that people would look at us as a church and just see your Son and just say, wow, there's Christ. That's what we want. So come sit on the throne of this church and this people. Lord, please protect them. Please do not lead us into temptation, because we are so prone to it. But we do ask for your protection. And we are grateful that you've given us this nation, and we've had so many years of freedom as the church here. Lord, we do ask that you'd forgive us as a nation, too. We are wandering. And Lord, we ask that you would just come and use your word and your spirit and your gospel, your church, and this nation. We long to see repentance here, and we long to see you on the throne. So help our leaders and just come and save souls. Father, thank you. We ask that you just take great joy in our service today. And it's through the name of your Son we pray. Amen. All right. Well, just a couple announcements real quick here. If you turn to your bulletins. Turn to mine. First off, next Sunday is going to be our quarterly meeting. So we just ask that you guys would come to that. It'll be during the Sunday school hour. And we're just going to come and be together as a family and just hear what God's doing in all the different ministries and be praying with one another. So that's next Sunday again. Also, Women's R&R, that's coming up. That's going to be July 17th, 6 to 8 p.m. That'll be outside, Lord willing. So ladies, we just want to extend an invite to you. Also, the high school camping trip is coming up, so if you are interested, we're pretty much full, but if you are interested, you can still come talk to me. We're going to be taking off here in a couple weeks, so it'll be really fun going up to Crow Wing and just camping, being outside, and digging into God's Word, so it'll be great. And let's see, a lot of summer things coming up here. VBS, that's going to be also a couple weeks, July 21st to the 25th. So if you have a child between the ages of 3 and I believe up to 6th grade, right? Yep. If you would like to attend that, we just ask that you go to that link and register there. So kind of a side note there, if we still need a few extra things for VBS. So if you're interested, and I think we mostly need supplies for snacks at this point. If you're interested in helping there, there's a link you can go to or talk to Renee Quant or Brooke Bonzi. So, also, Sunday, July 28th, we have a potluck right after the church. We're just going to be hearing from the Johnstons and the Millers, just kind of what their ministry is like in Asia. So please come to that. It would just be great. Even if you end up not providing food, we'd love to have you come. So let's see. I think that's it. Oh, Dario, if you are interested, she just lost her husband. And if you're interested in providing a meal for her, there is a link in the bulletin, I believe, yeah, that you can sign up for to take her a meal. So that always goes a long way, especially when you're grieving. So we just appreciate that. All right. Well, let's just take a moment and stand and greet one another this morning, and then we'll continue on in song.
by the blood of Christ. Ephesians 2.
My soul unnecessarily.
receive. We serve a good God who is good to us. And part of our worship and our obedience is to give back what God has graciously given. So this time we'll continue worshiping through the giving of our tithes and offerings. If you are a children's church worker and you would like to take communion at this time, you're welcome to join us up front as well. And as we do this, let's sing one more time, "God, You're So Good," as we take our offering.
Say kids ages, let's see, I think 3-year-old through 3rd grade today can be dismissed. So you guys can go ahead and head on out. And then we'll say our fighter verse together this morning. So if you please stand with me, we'll read this out loud together. This is Proverbs 17:9 and 22. Let's read this together. Whoever covers the net seeks love. But he who repeats the matter separates close friends. A joyful heart is good medicine, but a crushed spirit dries up the bones. And our sermon text this morning is 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 10. Hear the word of the Lord. If you put these things before the brothers, you will be a good servant of Christ Jesus, being trained in the words of the faith and of the good doctrine that you have followed. Have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. Rather, train yourself for godliness. For while bodily training is of some value, godliness is of value in every way, as it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance. For to this end we toil and strive, because we have our hope set on the living God, who is the Savior of all people, especially of those who believe. You may be seated. Morning. Let's go to the Lord together in prayer once more. Father, we're thankful for your holy word, that you speak to us through your word. Lord, we're so thankful for the instruction that you give us, as well as the encouragement that you give us to help us to follow you, Lord. And so, Father, I pray that as we look into this passage this morning, that you would help us to be a people who truly do train ourselves for godliness, and that you would uphold us by your promises and by your grace and your mercy, so that we might do so in your power and in your strength, Lord. And so encourage our hearts this morning now to pray. Would you help me, Lord? Give me your grace to preach your word faithfully, and would you open up our hearts to all that you would have to say to us? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Growing as a Christian is not easy, is it? It's hard to grow as a Christian. It takes time. It takes effort, The devil fights against us to try to prevent us from growing. And the process of growing in the Christian life involves going through sufferings. Why should you and I pursue godliness? Paul tells Timothy in verse 7, train yourself for godliness. Why should we do that? Why should we care about godliness? Why should we go through all the efforts and all the difficulties that are involved with growing in godliness? That's what we're going to look into this morning. Paul is not only going to tell us that we should train ourselves for godliness, but he's also going to tell us why this is so important. And he has a message for us. The message is, it's worth it. It is absolutely worth it. Growing as a Christian is hard, yes, but it is worth everything that you need to go through in order to become more and more like Christ. And so this morning, we're going to try to answer a few questions from this text. First of all, what is godliness? Let's try to define a little bit specifically what that is. Secondly, what does it mean to train yourself for godliness? Thirdly, why should we do it? Why is it worth the effort? And then fourth, how do we train ourselves for godliness? How do we actually do this practically? So that's where we're going, and that's what verses 7 through 10 are really going to focus on. But first of all, before we get there, I just want to point out something that I think is really helpful here in verse 6, the first verse of this passage. Paul begins here in verse 6 by saying, if you put these things before the brothers, you will be a good servant of Christ Jesus, being trained in the words of the faith and of the good doctrine that you have followed. Now, what are these things that Timothy is supposed to put before the brothers, the things that he's supposed to teach to the church? Well, it's the things that Paul has just written about in verses 1 through 5. Remember from last week, Paul told Timothy at the beginning of chapter 4 that there are going to be false teachers who try to lead God's people astray. And the things that they teach are ultimately demonic, and they are dangerous. And so now in verse 6, Paul is telling Timothy, you need to point these things out, Timothy. That is, you know that there's going to be false teaching, and so expose it, Timothy, and give the church the truth that they need to understand so that they're not duped by this false teaching. Don't let the church be led astray. Warn them about these false teachers. Keep them from being deceived by teaching the truth to the church. And so he's telling us, he's telling Timothy, you need to be diligent to teach God's truth to God's people. And I want you to notice that verse 6 says that if Timothy does this, he will be a good servant of Christ Jesus. Be a good servant of the Lord. Now this is really important. Here's why this is so important. What does Jesus want to see happen in all of his people's lives? He wants us to be nourished with the truth of his word. Jesus wants his sheep to be well fed. Remember what Jesus said to Peter after he rose from the dead, John 21? He asked Peter, do you love me more than these? Peter said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And Jesus said to him, feed my lambs. He's telling Peter, I don't want my sheep to starve. They need nourishment so that they can be healthy, so that they can grow. I don't want them to be poisoned with rotten food, as with false teaching. Peter, teach them the truth. Teach them my word. I love my sheep, Peter, so I'm sending you to feed them. That's the calling that Jesus gave to Peter. It's basically the same calling that Jesus gave to Timothy. And Paul is simply saying here, Timothy, do you want to be a good servant of Christ Jesus? Do you want to serve Christ well? Then feed his sheep. Teach them the truth. Guard them from false teaching. This is the same calling that Jesus has, really, for every minister of his word. It's a calling, feed my sheep. That's what I'm called to do. That's what all of us as elders are called to do. Why? Why does Jesus call us to do this? Because Jesus loves you. Because Jesus is your shepherd, and he is a good shepherd. And he wants you to be spiritually healthy. He wants you to be joyful. He wants you to grow and to be strong in your faith. And so that's why he calls every minister of the gospel, feed my sheep, give them good food, teach them my word. That's the only thing that's going to feed them. Don't give them junk food. Don't give them your own opinions. Don't give them entertainment. Give them the soul-nourishing food of my word. And so, I want you to see that in verse 6 because I think it's really important. Jesus loves you and he wants you to be fed by his word.
And so now we're going to move on to verse 7, and we're going to focus in for the rest of this time on this whole idea of training yourself for godliness. Verse 7 says, "Have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths." Don't have anything to do with false teaching. "Rather, train yourself for godliness." The pursuit of godliness is important, not just for people like Timothy, not just for pastors and elders. It's important for every Christian. And before we go any further, I just want to ask the question, so what exactly is godliness? Really, you can only train yourself for it if you know what it is, right? And so, let's just get some clarity. What is this idea of godliness talking about? What is this thing we're supposed to pursue? Well, earlier this year, as we were studying some of the Psalms, a few times we saw that the Psalms really emphasize the fear of the Lord. This idea of godliness is basically the New Testament version of the fear of the Lord. In fact, it's interesting that the Greek version of the Old Testament that was translated about 250 BC often translates fear of the Lord with the word godliness. Godliness begins then at the same place that the fear of the Lord begins, which is with knowing God. Knowing God is the most important ingredient of godliness. It starts with having a personal relationship with Him, a relationship that's filled with loving reverence toward the Lord. When you hear the word godliness, you might think at first that it's about your behavior. You know, try to do good things, try to not do bad things. But really, it goes much deeper than that. If you and I want to be godly, we need to begin by knowing God Himself. When you know Him for who He is, you realize God is holy. He is glorious. He is the sovereign King who rules over the universe. And when we realize that that's who He is, how can we respond to Him but by loving Him and worshiping Him? The majesty and splendor of God should lead us to humble reverence and awe before the Lord. And the Bible also teaches us that even though God is infinitely higher than us, in His grace and His kindness, He sent His Son to become one of us and to become a lowly servant and to save us through His death and resurrection. And so the humble reverence that we have towards God should also be a joyful reverence, a reverence that's filled with love and with delight and with gratitude because our sovereign King has been unfathomably gracious to us. So that's where godliness really begins. It begins with a relationship with God. It begins with a heart that's filled with loving reverence, with joyful awe because of who God is, because of what He's done for us in Christ. And so then with that as the foundation, godliness is then worked out in the way that you live your life. When you know God and you love Him and you worship Him, how do you want to live? Well, you want to seek to do everything for His glory. You want to trust Him and walk by faith. You want to love your neighbor as yourself. You want to make it your goal to please God and to follow His word. You want to fight against temptation and seek to be a faithful witness for Christ. I'm sure that we can think of plenty of different ways that godliness can be worked out in the way that we live our lives every single day. And the important thing here is that it begins with a relationship with God. The fear of the Lord, a loving reverence. And then that relationship with Him transforms the way that we live every day. And so if that's what we're pursuing, if that's the kind of godliness that God wants us to have in our lives, then we should ask the next question, which is, what does it mean to train yourself for godliness? What does it mean to do this kind of training? I'm not asking how you do it. We'll get to that in a little while. But first of all, I want to think about this idea of training yourself for godliness. What exactly does this mean? Well, Paul has in mind here the idea of training as an athlete. In the ancient world, athletes would train themselves to compete in the Olympic Games, just like today, and to compete in other athletic events. In fact, in the city of Ephesus, where Timothy was ministering, children were often trained to be successful athletes. This is a normal part of their upbringing in Ephesus. And so that's what Paul has in mind when he thinks about training yourself for godliness. He's got this athletic training imagery in mind. Now, most of us here are probably not going to train ourselves for the Olympics. At least I'm not. But we at least understand the idea of training yourself to get into good shape and to be healthy and to get enough exercise. So what does that kind of training involve for us? Well, for one thing, it requires effort, doesn't it? If you go to the Garner Rec Center and you hang out in the weight room for a while and you talk to your friends there, and then you stand up there on the second level and watch the people playing basketball, and then you sit and relax on the comfy furniture right beside the door, and then you go home without doing any exercise, that's not going to help you at all, is it? Even if you show up at the rec center for 2 hours a day, every single day, if you don't put in any effort, if you just sit there and eat a Snickers bar, you're not going to get any stronger or faster or healthier. And the same is true when it comes to training yourself for godliness. If you don't put in any effort, you're not going to grow in godliness. Now, of course, our efforts to grow in godliness need to be done in the power of the Holy Spirit. We're going to talk about that a little bit later, but we do make an effort. 2 Timothy 1, listen to this. Peter writes, I'm sorry, 2 Peter 1, verses 5 through 7. For this very reason, make every effort to supplement your faith with virtue, and virtue with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with steadfastness, and steadfastness with godliness, same word that Paul is using in 1 Timothy, and godliness with brotherly affection, and brotherly affection with love. And so we can't be passive Christians if we expect to grow. We need to put in the effort that's required. And so training yourself for godliness involves effort, and it also requires time and patience. You don't show up at the gym one day and bench press 100 pounds and then show up the next week and expect to bench press 200 pounds. Physical training takes time. Getting into better shape usually happens slowly. That's why it requires patience and discipline and really commitment, dedication. Do you know what the busiest month of the year is for almost every gym, for almost every fitness center in this whole country? It's January. Because people make New Year's resolutions to get themselves into shape. If you show up at just about any gym in the month of January, it's going to be packed full of people. But by the middle of February, it's going to be completely back to normal. Because resolutions don't stick. People give up. And they find out getting into good shape takes time, it requires patience, and really the same is true for training yourself in godliness. It's really a temptation for us as Christians to give up when we don't see the results immediately. Maybe you begin reading the Bible every day, and after a week or two, your life isn't immediately transformed. And maybe you find out, well, there are some things in this book that are hard to understand. What should you do at that point? Here's what you should do. You should tell yourself, this is normal. This is what I should expect. This is not a surprise. You should tell yourself, of course this is challenging. Of course I'm not just blasting off spiritually into the stratosphere. This is going to take time for me to grow. It's going to take patience. And I need to trust that it's going to be worth the effort over the long haul. And so training yourself for anything, including godliness, involves effort and it requires time and patience. But I think we should also be encouraged that if you do persevere, you will grow in godliness. Your efforts are going to be worth it. You know, if you're consistent in working out, and you stick to your routine, and you show up consistently to exercise, you're probably not going to notice big improvements within a few weeks or even a month or two. But you know what? You will notice improvements after a year, won't you? Have you ever met someone that said, you know, this whole last year, I worked out 3 times a week. For an hour every time. I ran, I biked, I lifted weights, and you know what? I am not one bit healthier today than I was a year ago. It made no difference for me at all. Well, of course not. That's silly. When you take the longer view, you can actually look back and see the results of your physical training. You can look back to a year ago and say, you know what? By the grace of God, I've gotten a little bit stronger and I've lost 5 pounds. That's progress. The same is true with training yourself for godliness. Don't be discouraged if you don't see results over the first month or two. Over time, you will see results. You will grow as a Christian. You will become more like Christ. we can be encouraged about this because you know what? The Holy Spirit is living in you. You're not doing this on your own. The supernatural power of God is at work in you. And so if you're willing to train yourself for godliness, you can trust that you will, in fact, grow in godliness. Just this past weekend, we had some missionary friends that stopped by our house and spent the night. They were traveling through the state. And it was really fun to get to catch up with them. We haven't seen them for 5 years. And it was really fun to hear just how much things have, just how much work God has done, really, in the last several years that they've been over in Guinea in West Africa. And there were a couple moments there where, for Carl and myself, and then for this missionary couple, the light kind of turned on, like, oh yeah, that's right, 5 years ago, you guys were dealing with that. And now, look at how God has worked. And things have just improved so much. And even in our own lives, oh yeah, 5 years ago, we were dealing with this, and look what God has done. We're going to find that in our lives as we persevere in training ourselves for godliness. And so I want to move on to the next question now. Why is this worth all the effort? A lot of people think to themselves, you know, I'm just not interested in physical training. It's too hard. I don't have the time for it. I'm happy where I'm at. And they don't train themselves physically. And the reality is that a lot of Christians do the same with training themselves for godliness. It's too hard. I don't have the time for it. I'm happy where I'm at. And so, why should we go through all of this difficulty? Why should we persevere in the pursuit of godliness? In fact, in 2 Timothy, it says, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. And so why should we do something when we know we're going to be persecuted for it? Well, Paul's going to give us three reasons why this is worth it, verses 8 through 10. First of all, in the first part of verse 8, he writes, for while bodily training is of some value, godliness is of value in every way, as it holds promise for the present life. I'm going to stop there for now. There are wonderful benefits that come from pursuing godliness, even in this life. In fact, later in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 6 says, godliness with contentment is great gain. It's not just a little bit of gain, it is great gain. Not financial gain. The context is clear about that. It's actually much better than that. What do you gain when you grow in godliness? Well, for one thing, you enjoy a closer walk with God. And that in itself is enough, isn't it? I mean, to know God, to enjoy fellowship with Him, there's nothing greater than that in all the world. You also experience a deeper joy in the Lord. You experience the freedom that comes from having a clean conscience. You experience a more vibrant witness as you shine the light of Christ. We can think of many more benefits that come to us. You know, people pursue physical training because of the benefits that it brings. Exercise helps you to be in good shape and to be more healthy and have more energy and strength. Paul is saying here, bodily training is of some value. But the value that's found in training yourself for godliness is far greater. And so pursue that. Pursue that value. Pursue your joy in God. Pursue a closer walk with Him. Experience the abundant life that Christ has for you. Now, a second reason that this training is worth it is that godliness holds promise not only for this present life, but also for the life to come, as it says at the end of verse 8. Towards the end of this letter, verse 19 of chapter 6, Paul talks about Christians storing up treasure for themselves as a good foundation for the future. Jesus talked a lot about that idea of storing up treasure for ourselves in heaven. And the fact is that if you pursue godliness, you will be rewarded in eternity. What's that reward going to look like? I'm not exactly sure. I think it's greater than I can imagine. But we do know this. It's going to be way out of proportion compared to the effort that we put into it. When we get to heaven and Jesus gives us our eternal reward, we're going to say, Lord, I don't deserve all of this. I don't even deserve 1/1000th of this reward you're giving to me, Lord. You're far too generous. But that's the way that God loves to reward His children. When you train yourself for godliness, there is an eternal reward that you're going to receive that's far greater than all of the difficulty that's involved in training yourself for godliness. Now, the third reason why this is worth it is because training yourself for godliness was one of the highest priorities in Paul's ministry. Verses 9 and 10. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance. That is the saying in verse 8 about the value of godliness. And look at verse 10. For to this end we toil and strive, because we have our hope set on the living God, who is the Savior of all people, especially those who believe. When you think about Paul's ministry, it was full of toil and striving, wasn't it? When you think about all the sufferings that he went through, being shipwrecked, being arrested, being beaten, he worked so hard, even to provide for himself, making tents so that he could minister in his time and not have to charge people any money for it, but he could just freely give them the gospel. He toiled so hard. Why? Because he wants to help Christians to grow in godliness. He wants to reach people with the gospel, and then once people are reached, he wants them to not just stay where they're at, but to grow in godliness. He doesn't want believers to be immature. He wants to help them to know God, to follow Christ, to live godly lives. It's interesting that in Colossians chapter 1, Paul talks again about this idea of toiling and striving. He uses the very same language. He says, Colossians 1, verses 28 and 29, Him we proclaim, that is, Christ we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom, that we may present everyone mature in Christ. For this I toil, struggling, or it's the same word translated striving in 1 Timothy 4. So for this I toil, striving with all of his energy that he powerfully works within me. And so in Colossians 1, why does Paul toil and strive so hard? It's so that he may present everyone mature in Christ. And so, I think it's really interesting that in 1 Timothy, Paul says, I toil and I strive so as to help people to grow in godliness. In Colossians 1, he says, I toil and strive to help Christians to grow in maturity. It's basically the same thing, isn't it? And so Paul did this. His ministry to Christians was devoted to this. And he did it because he had his hope set on the living God. He knew, God is my Savior. Christ has given me eternal life. I'm on my way to heaven. And so all of my toil and striving to help Christians to grow in godliness, it's going to be worth it. In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul takes a whole chapter to talk about the resurrection and the hope that we have, that we're going to be raised and enjoy eternity with Jesus. And he concludes by saying, therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. All that we do to serve Christ, to grow as Christians, to minister to others, it's worth it because we're going to be raised because Christ has given us eternal life. And so, do you see how this whole idea of growing in godliness is really shaped by the gospel? Paul is not saying, I need to help Christians grow in godliness so that they can earn their way to heaven. No, that's the furthest thing from his mind. We don't do this to try to earn our salvation. That would be legalism. Paul is just saying, I'm saved by God's grace. God is my Savior. My hope is sure. Christ has done everything to save me and to save all my brothers and sisters in Christ. And we're going to be perfect in God's eyes one day. Jesus is going to come back. He's going to transform us to be like himself. That's our destiny. And so if we're going to be like Jesus one day, why not grow to become more like Jesus even now? Isn't it wonderful to know? One day we will be perfectly godly. We will love God with all of our heart and soul and mind and strength. We will love our neighbors as ourselves. And so if that's how we're going to live for eternity, then let's, a friend of mine used to say it this way, let's live the lifestyle of the future even now. Christ died to save us, and so let's grow in godliness and become more like him. And so, when you look at these verses, I think we can say with all of our hearts, it is worth all of the effort, all of the time, all of the patience that we have to put in to train ourselves for godliness. It is worth it a million times more. And so now we need to ask the practical question. How do we do this? How exactly do we train ourselves for godliness? Let me just quickly give you 5 suggestions. First of all, the most important thing that we need to do to grow in godliness is to invest in our relationship with Christ. Think about this. When you do physical training, you're using your own strength to run or to ride the bike or to lift weights. You're using your own strength to do that, but when you train yourself for godliness, whose strength is it that's helping you to grow? It's not your own. It's the strength of Christ. Remember what Jesus said in John 15, "Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me." This is really a great invitation from Jesus, isn't it? He wants us to know him. He wants us to spend time with him and enjoy him. And he's inviting us, "Abide in me. Come to me. Feast on the bread of life. Drink of the living water that I give." And so at the end of the day, training yourself for godliness is not about following a bunch of rules. It's about knowing Jesus. It's about receiving his grace and his love and letting Jesus fill you with his life. And so this is the most important thing for us. We train ourselves for godliness by abiding in Christ. Secondly, and then I think this follows from the first, we need to let Jesus speak to us through his word. In other words, if we want to train ourselves for godliness, we need to read the training manual. Paul is really clear about this and how this works in the first verse of Titus. In Titus 1:1, he says that he writes, "For the sake of the faith of God's elect and their knowledge of the truth which accords with godliness." Do you see that? Our knowledge of the truth accords with godliness. We can only grow in godliness if we know the truth. And where do we find the truth? We find it right here in this book, in the Word of God. This is where we not only find the truth, but we learn it, and our hearts are nourished with the truth, and our lives are changed by the truth as we spend time in God's Word. I think I can even say that this is the most basic discipline, the fundamental discipline for training yourself in godliness. You know, in a lot of sports, there's one basic discipline or one basic skill that you need to start with every day in order to succeed. For example, what do you do if you're on the basketball team? What's the first thing that you do at practice? You run. Or if you're on the football team, what's the first thing that you do at practice? You run. It's the same way for a lot of sports. I've never especially enjoyed running myself. Thankfully, I was able to avoid that for the most part because I played on the golf team in high school. But in most sports, and for really physical training in general, the basic, most fundamental discipline is running. I think that with training ourselves for godliness, the basic discipline is spending time reading the Word of God. Thirdly, spending time in the fellowship of God's people helps us to grow in godliness. You know Proverbs 27:17, "As iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another." We can't do this by ourselves, can we? But God loves to use our brothers and sisters in Christ to correct us and to encourage us. Really, if you think again of this idea of running, we need people running alongside of us and encouraging us and helping us to keep going. And we can do the same for them. Fourth, we need to know what the temptations are that we're susceptible to so that we can fight against them. If you are running on the path of godliness, the devil wants you to fall into a pit so that you crash. That's what temptation is designed to do. The devil likes to make a hole in the road and cover it with leaves so that as you're running along, you just fall right in there. And he wants to trap you like that. And so Romans 13:14 says, "But put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires." Make no provision for the flesh. Stay away from the pit, in other words. If you're running and you know there's a big hole in the road over there, then you're just going to say, I'm going to avoid that. I'm not even going to come close to falling off the path into that pit. It's the same thing with the temptations that we struggle with. If we know what those things are that are struggles for us, then we can put guardrails in our lives to help us to steer clear of temptation and to just not come anywhere near to it. And then fifth and finally, As we train ourselves for godliness, we need to prayerfully depend on God. We're commanded to put in the effort, as we've seen, but ultimately, the power to grow in godliness can only come from God Himself. And I think that this should be a huge encouragement for us. Philippians 2, 12 and 13 tells us, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Put in the effort. Why? Because it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for His good pleasure. Oh, that is just so encouraging. God is working in you. He's working to will and to work for His good pleasure. God hasn't left you to try to grow in godliness by your own strength. He is working in you every moment to even give you the desire to please Him. And so depend on Him. Trust in Him to help you. Avail yourself of His almighty power by depending on Him in prayer. Ask Him, God, do this work, even in my will, and then help me to live this in my life. And so will you train yourself for godliness? Will you believe that it really does hold promise, both for the present life and for the life to come? And will you trust in God to help you as you invest in your relationship with Christ, and as you prayerfully rely on the Holy Spirit to help you become more like Christ? Let's pray together. Father, we're so thankful that You have not left us on our own to grow as Christians, but that You have encouraged us with Your word, that You are at work in every one of our hearts as Your children to follow Christ, to grow, and to become more like Jesus. And so that's our prayer this morning, that You would work in our hearts, both to will and to work for Your good pleasure. Oh Lord, would you strengthen us and help us to put in the effort and the time that's needed. Help us to do so in faith so that we can persevere. And Lord, we pray that You would help us to know Christ more and more deeply, and to enjoy our relationship with Your Son Jesus, and to abide in Him so that we might become like Him. We pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. This week we got to celebrate the freedom that we have as a country. And as we come to the Lord's table, we get to celebrate the freedom that we have in Christ. 1 Timothy 2, if we just rewind in 1 Timothy a couple chapters, it says in verses 5 and 6, "For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave Himself as a ransom for all, which is the testimony given at the proper time." And this idea of Jesus giving Himself as a ransom, this is all about freedom. In the ancient world, the price that would be paid to buy somebody out of slavery was called a ransom. And the reality is that all of us were once slaves of sin. We were born dead in our sins and our trespasses, and we were enslaved to sin. It had the power to control us and to condemn us. But Jesus gave Himself up on the cross to pay the ransom price so that we could be set free. Now, because of that, if you are trusting Christ as your Savior, then you are no longer under the controlling power of sin. Sin has no power to condemn you to hell. You've been set free from death. You've been set free to experience the joy of the Lord. You have the freedom now to have hope and to have life. You have the freedom now to actually serve Christ instead of serving sin. You have the freedom to love God and to love your neighbor. What an amazing freedom that we have because Jesus gave Himself as the ransom price to set us free from slavery. And so, as we come to the Lord's table, let's come with grateful hearts because Jesus gave Himself to buy our freedom. If you know Christ as your Savior, if you're trusting in Him as the one who paid your ransom, then you're welcome to enjoy this meal with us this morning. You don't need to be a member of this particular church. You just need to be someone who's been ransomed by the blood of Christ, and you've put your faith in Him. If you don't know Christ, we ask that out of respect you would let the elements go by, or that even better, that even in this moment, that you would trust Jesus as the one who paid your ransom. Right now, as the elders come forward, let's just take a moment to quiet our hearts before the Lord and to prepare to receive the Lord's Supper.
What do you make for lunch and breakfast?
Our loving God and Father, this past week we celebrated the Independence Day. We have freedoms here that we can do things to praise and honor you. But we also need to remember that your Son came so that we can have the freedom to come to you, to give our lives to do your will. So Lord, we truly want to be thankful today for all these good things, for what your Son has done for us. We give you praise and thanks. In Christ's name.
We invite you to sing with us.
Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's eat together and be thankful. Amen. Todd, what do you think for the cup for us?
Heavenly Father, again, we just want to give you all praise and thanksgiving in our hearts back to you, because the fact that you sent your Son to pay a price that we could not, Lord, and we are just so thankful of that gift. It's beyond measure of how we can put any value on it. It is so very, very precious. King Jesus, we just want to acknowledge you as our King, and you came down and you lived a perfect life, so that a life that you could become that Lamb. And all the sin was poured, and the wrath of the Father was poured out on you. And we are thankful for that, because we could not do it again on our own. So, Lord, as we partake in the cup, we recognize your blood was spilt, and without that, we would not have the cleansing that we so need. And so, Father, again, thank you. And Jesus, we just give you the honor, and it's in your name we pray. Amen.
also, Jesus took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's drink together and be thankful. Let's pray together once more. Lord, we're so thankful for this profound mystery, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Oh, Lord Jesus, we're so thankful that you are living in us. Because of you, we've been redeemed, we've been set free, we have the hope of glory. You're helping us as we seek to pursue godliness, and we're so thankful that all of this is true only because of what you've done for us, Lord Jesus. And so we rejoice in you with grateful hearts this morning, and we do cry out all the glory evermore to you, Lord Jesus. In your name we pray. Let's stand together as we go with God's blessing. If you'd like to pray with someone this morning, there will be a prayer team available here at the front, and they'd love to spend some time with you today. So the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.